Welcome back, everyone, for another ISSA talk. I am Jenny Scott, senior content developer here with ISSA. Super excited to be back. I feel like I haven't recorded an episode in a while, but I have an amazing guest with us. He was also so gracious enough to come on to our podcast as well. So you'll be hearing more from this guy. He's got so much great information. I have with me Mr. Robert Linkul. How are you, Robert?
I'm doing great, my friend. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much. He actually reached out to me, you guys, because he wanted to share more with you. And I have more questions. So like I said, I feel like we're going to have him back on for several episodes. So keep your eyes out. But today, I really wanted to talk to him about some foundational stuff that he's doing. He trains the older adult, hence the TOA behind him, training the older adult. That is really his specialty. He's turned it into a massively successful career. So Robert, will you tell our viewers a little bit about yourself?
Absolutely. So yeah, we got to do the podcast. I was talking constantly and they were like, yo, we got to wrap this thing in like 3 hours. We'll do something else. So yeah, I appreciate you giving me time and chance to come back on and chat with you and being open to me reaching out. So thank you. So basically training the older adult TOA kind of came about from a bunch of injuries that I experienced at a really young age. At 24, I blew out my back as a NCAA hammer thrower. By 28, I had back surgery. And as I was recovering from that, I got really into mountaineering because I was training a bunch of clients who wanted to go climb some big mountains. So I went and climbed Mount Rainier and I came back and I'm training a bunch. I had 15 other clients. We were all going to go climb Shasta together. And as I'm sitting at a meal with them after a training day, I cough and I look at my hands and my hands are covered in blood all across my hands, my forearms. I coughed all over the table and I was floored. I was shocked by the amount of this that just came out of me and I went, what is going on here? And my clients were looking at me like somebody just threw a red water balloon on me, like it was everywhere. And I was just like, I'm so sorry, you guys. I don't know what's going on. So I go to the hospital and they give me an x-ray and I've had x-rays in the past and it's 3-4 days. I get the x-ray, I get in the car. Before I leave the parking lot, they're like, come back, you have to come back. And so I go back in and they do another one and they're like, we found a tumor in your lung and it's big and it's gonna kill you. And we were like, whoa. And so within 24 hours I'm in, I get a bronchoscopy. They go up through my nose and they show my lung and it's just filled by this carcinoid tumor. And they're like, yeah, you gotta have surgery. So I have a carcinoid tumor removed. They have to take out two of my ribs and they have to cut my lat, my intercostals and just everything. It's this massive surgery and I have to rehabilitate from that. Luckily, I didn't have to go into any radiation or any treatment or anything, just a big surgery. And as I'm recovering from that, they found another tumor in my thyroid. My thyroid was 4 times as big as it should be. And they go, another carcinoid tumor. And so I end up having a thyroidectomy and have that taken out. They hit my vocal cords. I can't talk for 3 weeks. It was quite the experience. And then I end up destroying both of my hips through all the years of lifting. So I end up getting arthroscopies on both hips. 2 years later, I get full total hip replacements on both hips. My left one dislocates 7 times in 24 hours. I have to have a whole revision on that. I end up with a hernia, 3 different surgeries on my wrist, all this stuff, all of these injuries, sciaticas and flare-ups and all of this, all before the age of 40. And it just gave me a really unique experience in life to look at this and be like, this is happening for a reason. It's not happening to me. It's happening for me. I steal that line from Tony Robbins. And it's like, what are you supposed to be learning from this? And to me, it gave me a really unique opportunity to connect with a 70-year-old who's going through these things and find a way to train and rehabilitate and either prevent or overcome these. But I got to do it 35 years ahead of them. And so now I can put that into action. And as I'm doing that, other trainers are calling and messaging me, what are you doing and how are you helping them? And I'm just answering the same questions. And finally, we have a guy named Jerry in Texas, who's our first TOA affiliate. He goes, why don't you like make a certification? And I said, that's a good idea. And so we did, we built a certificate and we had some business stuff and mostly it's programming this and that. And he got into it. He was the first one and 2 years in, he goes, you know, I do your programming. I do all this. Why don't you let me be a TOA? I'll be TOA Texas. And I said, that's a great idea. And so this guy's just helped us kind of build our business. So now we have 14 TOAs affiliates across the country. We have one international in Vancouver in Canada. And we work with hundreds of different trainers that are out there working in private gyms and studios. They're all over the place that are working with people, you know, active agers, older adults, over 50 with limitations or injuries or something they need to overcome. And we show them how to do it. Not where they're avoiding the limitation, but they're training with it and making people better. This way they can enjoy their retirement. They can enjoy those golden years instead of getting 3 or 4 of them at really poor quality of life, and then they die. So we want them to live longer and live better.
Absolutely. And so for those of you guys who don't have the perspective, whether you've been in the industry for a while, like I've been in for about 15 years, Robert's been in for decades, like we want to make sure that you guys understand that this population isn't going away. There was a recent report that was put out in the beginning of 2023 that said that in the next 10 years, you guys, more than half of the world's population is going to be technically older adults, senior population, 65 and up. They're living longer and they want to have, like Robert said, a better quality of life. And so if you're interested in training this population, we're here to tell you, and that's why I brought him back. He is someone who can show you that this is an absolutely valid population to be working with. And we're going to talk about it in a little bit here, but you have some clients that you've had for 10, 15, 20 years. Like, that's insane. The average client is with somebody for less than a year in a regular gym, right? So we're going to talk about that in a little bit here. But I want to kind of start from the top with you, Robert. Can you tell anybody who's interested in taking on older clients anything that you think that maybe they should just be aware of or really pay attention to if that's the population that they really want to start taking on?
The big one that comes up to me all the time is, I don't know what to do and how to do it without hurting people. And so learn as much as you can about diseases and limitations, learn your anatomy. I've had that debate so many times with seasoned pros. They're like, I didn't go to college and I don't need anatomy and I learn everything I need to learn from a book. And I'm sure you can do that. The more you're going to know about the human body, the better. There's no point where you're like, well, that's all I need to know. Are you kidding? I mean, the more musculature, you know, the more functionality, the biomechanics, the leverage systems of the body, the better you're going to be as a coach of being able to create some of the different exercises that really get what you want. So this is a nonstop, constant work in motion, always trying to learn the best and most efficient ways. So stay very up to date with the research, different strategies. Right now, I'm in a unique place because I'm on the board of directors for the NSCA, and that position has given me an opportunity to gain access to research that's not necessarily being published. It's being presented to be published, and I get to see all of it. And then the publishers go, "Well, we'll take these couple," and so I get to kind of cherry pick all this info. And a ton of it right now is focused on power training for older adults and how, like, bilateral training strength stability is much more efficient than anything unilateral you could do for true fall prevention. And you're like, well, you're on one foot when you're taking the step and it's this contralateral stride. And is that really the way? Well, the research, like, significantly supports traditional bilateral strength. So get your deadlifts, get your sit to stands, traditional two-handed rows, overhead presses, like just variations of bilateral lifting, getting people really strong foundational strength. That's the best thing you can do for them to prevent their falls. And so it doesn't need to be fancy, is my point. Like, research supports, just do the basics, do them well. And if you have limitations that come into the way, this is the second part of the answer, don't avoid those limitations. That's probably why the person has come to you in the first place. I got the shoulder that hurts. I got a hip that bugs me. I can't golf anymore, swim anymore, ski, whatever it is they want to go and do. You got to learn how to train with that limitation and hopefully overcome it. And some limitations you can't, others you might need the team, the physical therapist, their doctor, their behavioral counselor, the nutritionist, the whole team of people you're a part of. You're a significant part of, I should say. You're probably the linchpin that's holding it all together, because all those people we just talked about, I'm ranting, but all those people we just talked about, you're the one they get to see two or three times a week. Everybody else, it's once a month, every quarter, you know, something like that. So you're probably the most important one in that connection. So you got to know what to do with them with these injuries. You can't avoid it. Because if we look at the body as like power systems, right? And bars, if everything that's good continues to train, but the one thing that's hurt doesn't, are you doing them a service or a disservice, right? You're making a bigger gap. They're just going to get more hurt, you know? So you've got to learn what to do with them. And this is not a plug of like, come do my pro. It's not. It's just go learn. Just learn. If you pick me, that's awesome. If not, I know some other folks that are pretty good educators out there that are putting out good content. Just never stop learning. Never stop learning.
No, funny that you say that, Robert, because this morning, actually, it's the beginning of May right now when we're recording this, somebody had posted on our Facebook page, and I facilitate our Facebook page most days, and they asked, I have an older adult, and they listed some conditions that this person had and like in the past and that they were recovering from and being treated for. How do I train them? And that was their question. And so my question for you is, when people come across different conditions or different limitations, like you mentioned, it's something that maybe they haven't experienced before. They should go out and learn about it, but then take what they know now and then use it in the future. But they're going to come across things that they don't know, right?
Oh yeah. I'm on my 23rd year and I came across something the other day and I'm like, my client goes, look at my x-ray. Here's the report. And I'm like, I don't know what the hell this is. So I'm in there, you know, doing my search, trying to figure it out. And a lot of times you do that search and when it comes up and it's like, something major, you know, something simple, patellar tendonitis. Okay. Let's go with that. And you're like, I don't know what to do. You shouldn't know what to do. Your job is not to diagnose and treat. That's not your job. Yeah. Your job is to let the physical therapist and the doctor do that. And then you talk to them and you're like, well, what can they do and what can they not do? And all of us speak the same language. Well, they can hinge and they can row and they can press, but they can't jump. And you're like, cool. I know exactly what to do and what not to do now, right? So now I can take the ball and run. Now, the next time a client comes in and they're like, I have patellar tendonitis, you're like, I got a pretty good idea what to do. However, go see your doctor and see your physical, get the team involved, right? You're always going to have to do that, but you're just so much more equipped. So 5, 6, 7, 8 clients down the road, they come in and they're like, I've got patellar tendonitis. You're like, you came to the right place, baby. Like, I know exactly what to do. Go get your doctor's release note. Come on back. We're going to take care of this. That's basically how this came about, was older person after older person. Hey, I got a bad back. I got a bad hip. I got a bad back, a bad hip. And I'm like, they just kept coming. Every client kept sending me their friends with a bad back or a bad hip. Why? Because I had a bad back and I had a bad hip. And I learned how to rehab that. And that just kind of grew, right? So you'll become that. You'll become an expert on something. And that level of expertise will continue to grow. And that creates clout. And next thing you know, you're the person to go to in your gym. And then it becomes the community. And then it becomes the town. And then in your region. And next thing you know, some awesome people ask you to come onto a podcast. And you get to share some information, right? And it goes from there. That's how this thing is done. And that's the profession of being a trainer, not this is my job and I'm going to do it on the side to make some extra cash. You have that level of commitment where you're like, whatever you throw at me, I could know it, I could not know it. I'm going to figure out how to do this the best I can and we'll tackle it together.
I love that. Yeah. So keep learning. But yeah, it can get you into a point where you are the specialist for that thing. I love that.
Absolutely.
You mentioned some different movement patterns. You mentioned hinging, and you and I were kind of talking offline. I want you to talk more about this to our viewers, about different movement patterns that you feel that people are underutilizing, specifically with older adults. And then give us that example you were talking about with knee issues earlier.
Yeah. So basically, we look at older adults in three kind of categories. Frail elders, and I'm going to put numbers, but again, this is more of a biological thing than it is a chronological thing. So I'll throw numbers on here, but it doesn't mean like, well, you're 70, you belong over here. I'm going to say 70 to 90-ish. Frail elder, can't get up and down off the floor, can't go up and down stairs, cannot carry load to and from, is a huge fall risk, okay? So you have kind of a category of people there, and there's going to be a criteria of movement patterns we want to do specific to them. Then next, you're going to have your traditional older adult, 50 to 70, somewhere around in there, has trouble getting up and down from the stairs, up and down off the floor, carrying load, but they can do it. They're just not great at it. They're a moderate fall risk. And then you have like your active aging athletes, almost, your people that are very capable, very able. They're doing great. They still have some limitations, but can get up and down stairs, up and down off the floor. They can carry load. They maybe even can jump a little bit. Like, they can do some rather dynamic things. They're all going to have different criteria of things that they want to do, starting pretty simplistic and moving to more dynamic, explosive, complex, sporting based movement patterns. So let's start over here with the frail elders. Okay. You have three movements that you want to do: a hinge, a row, and a carry. That's it. Just start with those three things. Train them for 12 weeks, 3 months, and just get really good at the basic patterns of life. I hinge over to get my shoes. I bring them towards my body. I carry them over to a chair. I hinge and I sit down. That's a loaded carry. I do the same with my purse, with my backpack, with my groceries, with the dog food, with the whatever it is, all the stuff that we're doing through life. We're basically taking something from over there and we're moving it over here, and then we do something with it and we move it back, and we're just doing carries all day long. That is the general locomotion of life built around three movement patterns. So let's train that. I don't need you to do corrective exercises on the floor. I don't need to do cats and dogs and open books and blah, blah. Let's just train. Let's just start getting you strong in the three things I know you can do. You can hinge, you can pull things towards you, and you can carry some weights, okay? And it could be 3 pounds. The fact that you got in here means you can walk, so I can have you carry something and move back and forth. So that's gonna be the start for the basics. That's gonna progress. We're gonna add in splits, which means a lunge or a step up or something like that. So we'll get into the older adults by doing that. and some type of overhead action, something where they're going to raise their arms to overhead, pull over to overhead, press to overhead, throw to overhead, something that's going to get them where their arms eventually end at 180 degrees or near it over their head. Okay, so hinge, carry, row. Then we're going to add split stance and overheads. And then after that, we're going to get dynamic, explosive, Olympic, whatever you want to call it. You're going to start doing things that are power-based. And for us, it's release drills. We throw things. And we'll throw things forward, and we'll throw them back, and we'll chest pass, and we'll slam, and we'll toss. And we do things, and clients love, because they get to let go.
Yeah.
You never get to let go. You never get to not like just, I'm just going to chuck it, and I don't have to worry about it. Like, they never get to do that. Everything's always slow and controlled, and 2 seconds and 2 seconds. Now I just, they're like, just let it go. And you're like, just let it go. And I'm like, yeah, just throw it, you know, just toss it. And they're like, sorry. And they like, oh yeah, just toss it. And I'm like, okay. And so you see these little old ladies are like, I get to slam this thing on the ground. I'm like, slam it as hard as you want. You session's free if you break it. And they're like,
yes, just I do that too. Rage, like, it's out. Free if you can break the ball.
Man, it's so fun. It's so fun. And you see this whole new level, and they never get to let go like that. And it's invigorating, because now they're seeing like, I don't have to be reserved with all this. But the benefit of that is huge, because these are the folks, we're not going to do depth jumps and bounds and skips and box jumps and barbell Olympic lifts with, but they need to learn how to move their body quick. So if I can teach them to accelerate and implement and then just let go of it and to put it into flight, their body got the acceleration, the preparation, the follow through. They got all the phases of movement and they got the benefit of it. They just didn't have the negative ramifications of the impact back on the ground. They can just let go. So that's whole thing is what TOA is built on. It's like, where are you? Are you one of these three, right? All of them, we're going to do probably a 12-week base strength foundation program to start, just adaptation phase, 3 months. Let's get you used to moving weights. And then we'll start to level this up. And whatever limitations come about, we're going to deal with those as they go. A knee, a hip, a back. Some people are going to have structural. I can talk forever, by the way. So if you want to go to the next question, you just flag me down. You're going to get to a point though, where like, I have a client who has a broken AC joint in his shoulder. He's 84 years, 88 years old, and they're not going to fix it. And so we're going to do the best we can with that joint, but I know I'm not going to be able to put his arm over his head. So it's like, okay, well, we can do bench press and we can do horizontal rows and we can do short flies and I can do pivot point presses where he can lean out to 100 degrees, but we can't get him to 180. So I'll do the best I can with that joint to make it as functional as I can. But will I ever fix him? No. Not unless he gets shoulder surgery, which they won't do. He's too old to do it, you know? So it's like, you're going to have some people, you're not going to be able to fix them. So what's the best answer? Do the best we can with what we got. Absolutely. Some people you're going to get at 80. The ship has sailed. It's so far down the line. Like, you can still see it, right? Like, there's still time to do something. But am I going to fix, you know, their Mr. Burns posture? I'll probably make it a little better before they, but it's, you know, we do the best we can with what we got. And that person could be 40, that person could be 80. It just, you look at that person that's in front of you and the abilities and the intentions of where you can take them, the potentials are huge, okay? It doesn't matter. You could get somebody at 90 who's never trained a day in their life, and I see someone who's completely green that has massive potential, right? But they're starting literally at level one. So if they get to a level 5 out of 10, that's fantastic. But I'll have other people that I'll get to a 10 over 15 or 20 years with them, you know? Anyway, I'm rambling at this point.
No, it makes perfect sense. I want you to tell these guys what you were talking to me about with the knee problems, the athlete that you knew had a knee problem. They started to train his posterior chain instead of the extension. Tell us about that.
You bet. So the client, Linda, is my longest tenured client with another gal named Ruth. I've had both of them since 2004. So we're on our 19th year of training.
That's crazy.
Together. I have 15 clients who've been with me for 15 years or more. They're just like the founding fathers and the founding grandmothers of my program. They've been with me since the beginning, and it's awesome. I trained for 4 years in Tahoe, and then I moved here to Sacramento, and they've been with me ever since. So with Linda, there's a shot putter from the 80s named Ulf Timmermann. He was from German block back at the time, East Germany. And he was a great shot putter. He threw 73 feet. He was a very good shot putter. Blew out both ACLs in training. And they said, hey, man, I think your career is over with. And he goes, well, I want to try this different variation of rehab. So they fixed both ACLs. And they said, you're an 80-20% quad dominant athlete. He was so quad dominant because his sport is all pushing. There's no pulling really involved in it. other than the fact of doing like clean pulls, a couple of lifts, everything else was pushing based. So he was so quad dominant, his knee just couldn't hold together anymore. So he goes, look, the next 18 months, we're not going to bend you at the knees at all. It's all going to be hinging based. So they hamstring curled him. They did RDLs. They did swings. They did bridges. They did kickstands. They did anything and everything they could to build his butt, his hamstrings, his calves, get the backside of his body strong. Did they ever seek a 50-50 equality? I don't think so. I'm sure they got semi-close. But the point is after 18 months of rehab and getting back into the sport, two or three competitions in, he throws 75 feet, sets a new world record, okay? Later broken by Randy Barnes, who had a very similar experience. Anyway, my throwing history, all of this kind of comes from this athlete. And it's like, that rang true. Well, if this is working for this elite level athlete, this will work for our regular folks. Yeah. So you'll see clients, as soon as you see them, they're like, they're all quad and there's no hamstring, no butt. And you're like, well, that's a Timmerman client. And that's what we nicknamed it, Alf Timmerman, the shot putter. So the Timmerman program is however long you're going to train somebody, we just minimize how much knee flexion they get. And we triple how much hip hinging and hamstring curling we put into their program. And we do that for 8 to 12 weeks. And then we retest or we reassess how they're doing. And you'll see that number one, knee pain, especially when ascending stairs, goes away within a couple of weeks. So what we thought was crepitus or something else of cracking, crunching, that actually decreases. So that's not true crepitus. That's gas exchange in your body. That'll always be there. If you're a gassy individual, the joint, you always have crepitus, no matter what, for the most part. So all of a sudden, our clients wouldn't hear as much noise. They wouldn't feel as much pain. Something was being changed in the anatomy of how their knee worked to actually improve their quality of function. And that, in return, improved their quality of life because they weren't in pain. They were having to take meds all the time. They didn't have to ice their knees and ache and stop doing all the things they like to do. So slowly, quality of life improved, performance improved. Eventually, we got to a point with Linda, who in like 2007 was supposed to have a double knee replacement. We're now in 2023, and she's probably knocking on the door now within the next 12 to 18 months of getting those knee replacements. Like, we prolonged that surgery, right? 15 years by getting the backside of her body stronger. And Ruth has done the same, and Tammy has done the same. Like, all these clients that I have, Lori and Steve and Pam and all the, almost all of them come in with a knee or a hip injury, and it's a very similar thing. You're either hip flexor dominant or quad dominant, and it's the same approach of the Timmerman actions. So I have a webinar. It's about 90 minutes. As you can tell, I like to talk, so I ramble a bit in that one too. But I go through the whole Timmerman program. It's on my YouTube. Feel free to hop on
there. Awesome. We'll link that in the description. You like it?
Absolutely. And I go through each movement. Here's all the exercises and reps and sets. I break the whole thing down in there. So you'll get to see some videos of Alf throwing and some of the ways that he trained. It was a very inspiring thing to do, but it's very fun to put that in with your clients. And it's challenging on the programming, you know, because you're like, wow, what if I couldn't bend my client's knees anymore? What would I do with them? You know, what if you couldn't push your upper body? What if they couldn't do that? And it's just like, well, what are we going to do? You got to get creative. They don't want to do seated rows all the time. Let's get creative. So yes. you got to go to the drawing board. And that's kind of the beauty of, let me teach you some recipes. Let me teach you how to cook. But you make this as fun and as fancy as you want. I heard the Cosgroves pitch it that way once. They're like, I'll teach you how to bake cookies, but you decide. Do you want them chocolate chip? Do you want vanilla? Do you want cream? Do you have triple decker? I'll show you the basics. You learn about the specific advancements that are special to this person, and you build that program to fit their needs.
I love that. Yeah, custom order is what I would call that. And we'll make sure to share Robert's social media information here in a few minutes, guys, because he's actually got some really great content. He puts it out regularly. And actually, this client, Linda, that he's talking about, he actually posted about her just the other day, and I saw the post and I was like, oh, look at her. She had a little belt on around her waist and she was pulling a sled backwards and stuff. I was like, look at her go.
So that's a big one. The knee drag, the dragging of a sled, be it whatever kind of sled it is. That was one of the torque tanks where we have the magnetic tension, but which is awesome because it's always the same tension, but whatever it is, the dragging dragging anatomy and anatomic application of that movement pattern for ACL and meniscus injuries is astronomically successful. Like, clients that have had debilitating career-ending injuries will rehab by doing 15 to 20 minutes of sled dragging before every workout, And that's it for the most part. They'll work range of motion, other stability stuff, but that's such a successful thing and it's so simple to do. We'll have clients that come in and they'll just back and forth, hey, for the next 5 minutes, get your knee therapy in, and we do this. So there's very good research to support that out there. It's so simple. Almost every gym you go to nowadays has a sled. And even if you don't, you can simulate it by hooking a couple super bands together, hooking onto a post. And as you start dragging backwards, it'll get tighter, tighter, tighter. Yeah. But then you get the eccentric control of walking it back, which can be even more beneficial. So drags are hugely successful for knees, not so much pushes. So if I'm in front of it pushing forward, it's a different anatomy at the knee. It's the drag that's really successful. So you trainers out there with clients with some ACL or just general knee pain clients, try dragging them and go easy. 2 minutes every workout for a couple of weeks and then 4 and 6 and build them up. But start throwing that in there and see what happens. I think you'll have good success.
That's awesome. So one thing I love about you, Robert, is that because you're so research-based and of course you're involved in research with the NSCA, which I absolutely love that organization. Actually, I have my journal of strength and conditioning right here. Because you're so involved in the research, much like I am, like I read these things cover to cover when they show up.
Totally.
That you are always like on the cutting edge and like always trying new things and learning new things and finding what's most effective. So again, guys, follow him on social media, listen to people like this, get the research, learn. Like you said earlier, this is an amazing talk because you're telling me all the things that I always tell everybody every day anyway. Like keep learning, but use the research, understand what it means for that person standing in front of you.
Absolutely.
And how can you apply it for this person instead of, you know, the athlete that they did the research on or whatever. It applies to the average person as well.
One more quick thing on that.
Yeah.
Is the people that author those research articles that you read, they want to talk about that content so badly and hardly anyone ever asks them about it.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, the one I was just referring to with the power training, with the eccentric and the bilateral strength training, all that, that's Jonathan Mike. That's a buddy of mine, right? I just called him up one day and I'm like, hey, can you explain eccentric training to me? And like 90 minutes later, I'm like, dude, I've taken up a lot of your time. And he's like, we're only halfway through the research, Rob. And he just keeps going. And I'm like, my point is don't be afraid to reach out to these people, friend them on it. If you message me and you're like, I just read your article and I have a few questions, I'm going to answer those questions.
Yeah.
You just read my article, right? I mean, it's a compliment because we want to put this information out. Don't be afraid to ask questions. At the end of presentations, we're like questions and the whole place is completely silent. And then one person will raise their hand and then we're off. Like be the person that raises their hand, get in there and get that information, take advantage of it because we want to talk about it.
I love that. Yes. Great, great tip. So I have one more question here for you, Robert. Have you noticed anything that you do differently when you're working with older adults as far as communication, right? From the average client or even working with kids, do you communicate differently with your older clients?
Yes. The first thing that comes to mind is the common misconception that you have to like, hello, Jenny, it's nice to see you today. Like they're not deaf and they're not so gone that they're not going to compute. So don't be patronizing. That's one really important one. If you watch the Limitless episode with Chris Hemsworth, in the last one,
yes.
he becomes an old man and everyone talks to him like that. And he's like, this shit's getting old. Like he gets really irritated quick. Clients are the same way. So my point is like, just because they're older, it doesn't mean they're not going to get it. Does everyone speak fitness? If you start talking about MCLs and ACLs and, you know, actin and myosin and origin heads and angle of pull, are they going to be like, I'm lost, bro? Anyone's going to be lost. Okay. So know who you're talking to, know your demographic, but still speak to them just like anyone else. So don't be patronizing. Number one. Number two, this demographic needs to know that you know what you're doing. Okay. If I'm 20 and I go into a gym and I'm like, I want to get jacked, bro. And the guy that I hire is jacked, hired. That's all I needed to know. Like, if you can do it to you, I think you can do it to me. That's about how we think when we're 20. When you're 65 and you got a jacked up hip and you're like, doctor goes, yeah, maybe you're going to need a hip replacement. You don't want jacked bro who doesn't know anything about this. You want someone that's going to come in and be like, I'm 27. I've read every article I can about hip replacements. I know the anatomy. I know the success rates. I know which doctors have been good. I follow them on Instagram. They've given me all kinds of advice. I've done two mini internships with these two trainers who specialize in working with people with older adults and who have hip issues themselves. I feel really prepared to help you with your hip injury if you choose me, right? And they go, all right, this is a young person who takes their job serious and is obsessed with the thing that I've come to them for, right? That's what I'm saying is you can do that with one person with a hip, okay? And then that guy does really well. And that guy goes, you know, my wife's got a bad shoulder. You were really obsessed about my hip. You think you can help with the shoulder? He's not going to go, oh, he's only a hip guy. I don't think he's going to go, this person's obsessed about what you do. Help me her with the shoulder. And you get the shoulder. And then you get her friend and her friend's grandma and the other grandma and the neighbor. Next thing you know, that's in a community of older adults in a retirement community where now you've got hundreds of potential customers. And what's better than a walking referral, right? Every flyer and billboard and anything else you give it, nothing's better than another client going, I go to him and he's fantastic. Okay. Think of restaurants that you go to. You're like, don't eat there. Food tastes like, you're like, I'm not going there. Right. But you get four people that are like, that's the best place ever. I love that movie. This, all you need is a walking referral. We will trust the people in our group. So when you do that with one customer, we call it the reach of three, their friends, their family, their colleagues, they're going to refer and talk about you to those three people. So if you're the obsessive smart trainer, that's fantastic. Be that one. Be the one that's always got the nose in that blue book whenever you're not training, right? And learning about what you do, and things are going to take off for you. But again, I start to ramble. Point being is, don't patronize them. Talk to them about why you're the right person for the job. And even if you're like, I don't know anything about hip replacements, but what I'm going to tell you is I am going to research obsessively about this and figure out exactly what to do. What's your doctor's name? What's your physical therapist's name? What's their phone number? Are you cool if I interview them? Do I have permission to share that I'm going to be training you? Like, get the system going, get in with the team. And now they're like, look how proactive this guy is. He's ready to go. He doesn't know what he's doing yet, but he's going to. I would feel confident with that, right? I mean, it's part of being a professional, and that's a career choice, not a job. You got to start thinking about yourself as a career trainer. This is not something you do on the side. It's not something that maybe I'm good at because you got a little bit of a passion for it. This, are you in or are you out, right? Yeah. If you're in, go all in, because our field, let me break this down. 380 million people, 280,000 trainers, okay? That's 360 potential customers for each of us. You guys think we can make it? Do you think you could train 360 people? I mean, the chance, I've got 60 clients. My schedule is full. I think my point is there are so many people that need us. There are so many people that can afford us. And especially this older population, they are more than willing. The average older adult spends $400 a month on their health and fitness. The average older adult. So that's us. That's us. That's a gym membership and twice a week with me, right? Yeah. So, I mean, they're there. They've got the money. They've got the passion. You need to show you're the right person. You'll have the job. And if you do that and you do it well, they're going to be there forever. Okay. The negative part about our job is eventually our clients pass away. And in 23 years, I've lost two, and it happened both last year. Yeah. So I had a pretty good run. I had a 21-year run where I didn't lose anybody. And that's a very rough thing to deal with.
For sure.
Because you're helping people, again, I'm sorry for the rant, but you're helping people from very low. You help build them up to where they're very high and capable and able, and then they get older and they pass. And you were a part of such a successful time of their life that they would not have been at without you.
Yeah.
That it's so rewarding to do this job. Vertical jumps and increase in bench press are great. But from a walker to I'm going on my vacation to Ireland, I've always wanted to do, that's life-changing.
Yeah, can't beat it. That's awesome. Really great points. And nobody's ever broken down the numbers like that. So I love that you stated that. And like, of course, this is the population you work with, so you know the statistics.
You want one more?
Yeah.
You want one more? Okay, listen to this one, okay? This one kind of blew my mind a little bit. The average American works until they're 61, okay? The average older adult dies at 73. So if you retire at 61, good math, people are better at math than me, and then you're going to die at 73, how many years does that give you to live? 12, okay? The last 2 years of life are at such poor quality, you can't get out of bed or do anything you want to do. So now we're down to 10 years of life. There's a year in there of declined health. So now we're down to 9 years of life. So you just worked for 40 plus years, save, all of this stuff to retire, to live the golden years for 9 years. And in those 9 years, are we spending every penny of that? You're like, no, I got to make it until I'm 100. So I'm going to divvy it out a little bit at a time. I'll take a trip every 5 years. Isn't it? So you get two trips in a decade. Okay. You go to Hawaii, you go to Europe, you get two trips in a decade, and then you start to die. And at 73, it's over with. These are individuals that do not resistance train, that do not sleep well, do not hydrate well, do not eat well, don't take any type of life prolonging efforts. Less than 14% of our country does that. So we're talking about 52 million people that are actually trying to live longer. Everybody else, they're going to die in about 9 to 12 years after retirement.
Wow.
And those years in there, how good can they be? They could be amazing. If we maximize them now, they go past 73 and you're like, sky's the limit, right? They're going to live to 90 and hopefully die doing something awesome, like mountain climbing or skydiving or something amazing. Go out with your boots on, right? Like that's, I don't want you to be stuck in a bed for 2 years, unable to do anything. That's miserable. That's a terrible way to go. Unfortunately, I've seen that with my family and others. That's where this passion and this energy comes from, of like, I get a chance to talk. I'm going to give you everything I can right now. I'm going to throw up all of this on you. I hope it sticks. I hope it helps. I hope you use it. Okay. Because I don't want those folks to get 9 years and that's it. I want them to get another 30.
Absolutely. Well, everything you just said, Robert, is if you're looking on a way, like for a way to market yourself with this population, you just gave it to them. Are you kidding me? And again, these statistics are real numbers. It's not just something you made up. This is real information, you guys. So if you're looking for ways to market, if you told me that and I was in my 50s or 60s and you told me that, I'd be like, excuse me, sign me up. Where do I sign? Like, what are we doing?
So there was a longevity increase of 7 to 10 years. Don't quote me on that, but it was almost basically another decade. Twice a week, 20 minutes of resistance training. That was it. We got 168 hours in a week and I just took 40 of them. Okay. And gave you 7 to 10 years. I have a YouTube video not too long ago. It's the most popular one I've ever put up. And it says, if I could tell you how you were going to die, would you change the way that you live? That's the title. And basically I break down all those numbers and I'm like, you're going to die between 71 and 73, right? With 2 years of miserable life before you go. 70, whatever percent of the people are going to go like that. So if I tell you that's going to happen, unless you start to do some of these other things, are you going to do them? Well, you could add 7 to 10 years with literally 2 20-minute resistance trainings a week. What if you started walking every day? What if you started cleaning up your diet? What if you slept a little better? What if you drank a little more water and a little less alcohol? What if you were a little more social and got outside and got some sun? Like, what if you started taking all these things that made you want to live longer? You might make it to 100, right? Every little bit of this helps. You're chopping down a tree a swing at a time, but all the matter, you know, they're all going to get you to where you're going. What's the intent? We can't just rely on medical intervention. That's going to give you 2 more years. That's what it's been proven to give you.
Yeah,
but what's the quality of those 2 years?
They're not going to be happy. Yeah, they're not going to be quality years. Absolutely.
It's the lowest quality. Mm-hmm. I mean, basically you can't get out of bed. That's unfortunately where my mom is right now. And I was just with her this weekend. Probably why I'm extra fired up about talking to you about it is I don't want that for anyone, let alone my own mother.
Absolutely. Absolutely, Robert. Well, again, you're going to be back. I'm telling you guys now, he's going to be back. But can you give our listeners a little bit more information about where they can find you?
We had 10 questions. I answered 3 of them.
No, I love it. That's why I'm going to have you back, because I could talk to you for hours. So let's do it.
Everything is my name. So just Robert Linkul, Instagram, Robert Linkul on Facebook, Robert Linkul on YouTube. And then our business, trainingtheolderadult.com. Head over to our website and check us out there. We have TOA Apex is coming up. That's our new frail elder program. That's going to be coming up this summer. TOA Select is our primary certification and everything. You'll be able to see it all on there. We've got tons of good stuff.
Perfect. Well, I will make sure to add those things to our description for this episode so everybody can find them very, very easily. But Robert, thank you again for joining us. And like I said, you'll be back because I want to know about all this equipment behind you. I have questions about exercises. I have so many questions for you. So I'm going to have you back very, very soon, guys. So keep an eye out. But thank you for joining me today, Robert.
My pleasure. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Absolutely. Yes. And thank you guys for watching. We'll be talking to you soon.